Two players are named semifinalists for a college football award, keys to victory for tomorrow's game against the Purdue Boilermakers, and an added wrinkle in the quest to expand the college football playoff. All that and more in this episode of Locked On Buckeyes.
You are Locked On Buckeyes, your daily podcast on the Ohio State Buckeyes. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
What is up, Buckeye fans? Welcome back to another episode of Locked On Buckeyes for the Locked On Podcast Network. I'm your host, Jay Stevens, also the host of the Jay Stevens Podcast. It is Friday, November 12th in the year 2021, and this episode of Locked On Buckeyes is brought to you by McDonald's, proudly serving communities since 1965. McDonald's has always been more than just a place to get tasty, affordable food. It's an unofficial community center. A big thank you to our friends at McDonald's for always being there. I'm loving it. I want to thank everyone out there for making Locked On Buckeyes your first listen of every single day. And I forgot to mention something earlier in the intro of the show. There's a big announcement coming at the end of today's show. You don't want to miss it. College football awards are a thing that, as a player, you always strive to receive that honor at the end of the season. As an Ohio State Buckeye football player, you know if you are a starter, you're probably going to find yourself on a semifinal list throughout some portion of your career at Ohio State because the standard is set that high. From quarterback to running back to offensive lineman to a linebacker or somebody in the secondary, every player out there that's starting at Ohio State, they know what the team standard is, and they know what the individual standard is as well. Well, there have been two Buckeye football players that were named to the semifinal list for the Walter Camp Award. The Walter Camp Award is one of the numerous awards players can receive at the end of the college football season. The Walter Camp Award is the Player of the Year Award. Now, you also heard about the Heisman. That's also a Player of the Year Award that's voted on by the Heisman Trust. Different than the Walter Camp Award and who votes on that. You also have the Outstanding Player Award or Player of the Year for the Maxwell Award. So there's three awards that all kind of had the same thing. The interesting thing about this is there are some years that the Maxwell Award winner and the Walter Camp Award winner, they're the same person, different than the Heisman. CJ Stroud, Trevion Henderson are the two individuals on this year's football team that are named on the semifinal list for the Walter Camp Award. The other semifinalists go as follows. Some of these names you will recognize. They're in the Big Ten. Some of these names you might not recognize. I just say, wait, how are they there? They're simply that good. The semifinalists go as follows. Will Anderson, linebacker from Alabama. Matt Corral, quarterback at Ole Miss. Jordan Davis, defensive lineman at Georgia. Jahan Dotson, Penn State wide receiver. Sam Hartman, quarterback at Wake Forest. Devin Lloyd, linebacker at Utah. Kenny Pickett, quarterback at Pittsburgh. Desmond Ridder, quarterback at Cincinnati. Kayvon Thibodeau, Oregon defensive lineman. Kenneth Walker III, running back from Michigan State. Have a game in a week against that young man. Caleb Williams, quarterback at Oklahoma, hasn't started that many games, hasn't played that much, but he is on the semifinal list. Bryce Young, quarterback at Alabama, and then Bailey Zappe, quarterback at Western Kentucky. And that young man, that team has played a whole lot better than I think numerous people thought they would. To date so far this season, the numbers for Stroud and Henderson, they might surprise you, because we're ultra critical of these two individuals and how they have played. When you look at the grand scheme of things in college football, they have wowed everybody. They continue to wow us as well. To date, CJ Stroud, 183 completions, 273 attempts, 2,675 passing yards, and 25 touchdowns. Trevion Henderson, this is going to amaze you, 128 carries, 937 rushing yards, 12 rushing touchdowns, 7.3 yards per carry. We're ultra critical of these individuals, and I am still amazed every time I look at their numbers. In my mind, I know how great of a season Stroud has had. I did not realize he was that close to 3,000 passing yards right now to date after missing a game. I did not realize that Trevion Henderson was that close to eclipsing the 1,000-yard rushing mark in his freshman season before the final two games of the regular season are even played. Unless something goes crazy tomorrow, Trevion Henderson will eclipse the 1,000-yard rushing mark, and it's very likely that C.J. Stroud will eclipse the 3,000 passing yard mark in only 9 games this season because he did miss one game this year against Akron. Just let that sink in a little bit. We're talking about Stroud and Henderson on a week-by-week basis, kind of being ultra-critical and trying to dissect and find ways they can improve. But when you look at the entire picture of college football, their season in totality, sometimes you got to take a step back and realize these two guys are balling. Now, I do know there are ways that both of them can play better, that both of them can have more improved stats, that both of them can execute better on the field. Those are things that you do on a week-by-week basis on podcasts like this. There are writers that write articles, and Ryan Day, Tony Alford, Kevin Wilson, Corey Dennis, they're all doing those things together to try to see how these guys can get better. But when you just look at the totality, not day-by-day analysis, almost said dialysis. I don't know where dialysis came from. When you look at things from the day-by-day analysis, a week-by-week or game-by-game, you're going to see totality. These guys are amazing. These guys, it's amazing that first-year starters at both positions, and they're making waves in this way. Walter Camp Award semifinalist C.J. Stroud, Trevion Henderson. The Walter Camp Award voters will announce 5 finalists on December 2nd, and then the winner will be announced on ESPN's College Football Awards show on December 9th. Will Stroud or Henderson win the award? I don't know. It's highly likely one of them will because they're having that good of seasons, and they're playing that well week in and week out. Thank you for tuning in to this episode of Locked On Buckeyes, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every single day. Tomorrow, at the end of tomorrow's game against Purdue, there will be a live post-game show reacting and analyzing how the Buckeyes perform in that game. Right now, I just recently checked. Let me pull this up here very quickly. The game spread, because I know a lot of people will want to know what the spread is and what Jay is thinking in regards to the point spread, brought to you by our friends at betonline.ag. Right now, according to betonline.ag, the spread for tomorrow's game is Buckeyes are their 21-point favorites. The over-under is 62.5. If you want to bet the over-under, be my guest. I'd probably steer away from that one. I do think, and I'll explain why I think this throughout this portion, I think the Buckeyes win. There's a really good shot. I'm leaning more towards the over on the point spread, not the under. You may say Purdue is pesky. Yes, they are. But this Ohio State team, I think, is going to have a couple wrinkles tomorrow that they're only one of the few teams in the college football that can do these things against Purdue. If you want to go a little bit further, first half point spread for this game is Ohio State minus 11. So if you want to go with that one, I would say go with the over with that one for sure. If you want to hit the point spread for the game, I would suggest the over for that one too. And here's why. I got a few keys to victory. These are things, the first two, not many teams in college football can really do both of these first two things that we're going to talk about here. Number one, assign 2 guys to George Karloftis on every single play. 6'5", 285-pound defensive end. He will sometimes move into the defensive tackle position. DeJuan Jones, in his press media availability, I believe on Wednesday, he stated that Jack Sawyer has given him a lot of looks, and he's been kind of the George Karloftis type of player in practice this week. The one thing is, Jack Sawyer is 250. That boy George Karloftis is 280. Yes, there's a big difference. You're going to see number 5 out there on the defensive line and say, that's a big boy. That's a big boy that should not be able to move like that. George Karlaftis is a game changer, a game wrecker. Now, I do think we'll see some things this week from Ryan Day that we didn't see last week, and I firmly think we should have seen some of these things last week from Ryan Day in the Ohio State offense. One of them, a lot of 12 personnel. Now, I was thinking more last week, if you're struggling with the running game, go more single back under center for Stroud, and then get Henderson to get a little bit more momentum. I do think you'll get more, maybe a little pistol look tomorrow, a little under center look tomorrow, to allow Henderson to get more of a momentum while going to the hole. Because if you're in shotgun and you're to the left or to the right, or maybe offset back a little bit from the quarterback, your momentum going to the line is a whole lot different than it is when you're in the I formation or single back formation directly behind the quarterback. So I do think that's one wrinkle. When I mentioned have two guys assigned to George Karlaftis, if you're going to have a single back set and it's a pistol or under center, one is going to be, it's going to be some momentum, but I do think you're going to find a little two back set. I do think you'll see a lot of, or two tight end sets, a lot of Stover, Cade Stover and Jeremy Ruckert combination. I do think you'll see some Ruckert and Mitch Rossi combination, because Rossi is a phenomenal, is a really good blocker. And I think in this game, you'll get a lot of a tackle and then a chip from the tight end coming off of the line, a tight end chip, and then a sliding over from the guard and the tackle. And you're really shifting and sliding your offensive line to the direction that George Karlaftis is. You do expect Purdue to send some pressure at times to try to get in the backfield to derail the timing of CJ Stroud tomorrow. But when you assign two guys to George Karlaftis, it's going to allow you to run the ball a whole lot better, because Karlaftis is a game wrecker. But then also, it's going to protect Stroud, because as much as people have been ultra critical of Stroud and him running the ball, part of the reason is sometimes he needs to escape the pocket. And he does, sometimes he does it a little bit too quickly. Sometimes he just needs to do it. And I do think for everything going on, you assign two guys to Karlaftis tomorrow, that's going to, one, derail the pass rush from Purdue, but then two, give Stroud the time that he needs and open up the holes for Henderson tomorrow. Number two, change things up. I have a couple things with this one. One, I think can happen. Two, just me being kind of an out-of-the-box analyst right now. Number two, change things up when going against David Bell. One thing I asked David Bell at Big Ten Media Days in July was, what are some ways he has improved his game in the offseason going into this year? And it was understanding different defenses and how teams will defend him. And as a guy that David Bell is, and the worker that he is, and how he continues to have all of these performances that wow everybody. CJ Stroud, no, wrong guy. David Bell in this game, if you don't change things up and mix them up, and I don't think that soft cover three, the cover three zone where there's a lot of space underneath, I don't think that's wise right now in this game. One missed tackle and David Bell could be to the house. He's not the fastest guy, but he does know how to get to the end zone as quick as possible. First, assign two guys to hit Karlaftis and to be on him every play. The other one, mix things up when covering David Bell. Now, here's a little wrinkle. I'm not sure if this is going to happen, but here's a wrinkle I would love to see it possibly happen tomorrow. No matter if it's Denzel Burke, no matter if it's Cam Brown, maybe Marcus Williamson, but I would kind of steer away from that one because he's phenomenal in that cover safety role and inside the box and in the run game. I would say kind of like a box and one in basketball. You have a box, four corners of the paint, and then you have somebody roaming and sticking on, like white on rice, the best player on the other team, where let's just say Dwayne Washington Jr. from basketball from last year. Can't do that for this year because they don't have that guy in the backcourt just yet that's going to need that much attention. Dwayne Washington Jr. from last year, and you're playing Illinois, and they want to bring in Andre Cabello, say you're starting this game and you're going to follow Jr. all over the court. That type of thing in football. Is it Burke? Is it Brown? I would say Burke follow Bell around all over the field. Not something you normally see in college football, but that would be an added wrinkle. You run your normal defense, and let's just say it's cover two. where you're going to have the cover two zone plus somebody playing man against against David Bell, a little outside of the box thinking, but that can happen. And I think that would be a little change if you change up with Burke and then Brown. Whatever you got to do, I think that'd be a nice little wrinkle that Jeff Brohm and his team is not expecting to slow down David Bell. Not something normal, but something you got to think outside of the box against players like David Bell. Number three, this one is something that Ohio State has not done recently. A few games that have been closer, they have gone away from something that has worked for them in the running game. As great as the numbers are for Trevion Henderson, he flourishes the best when it's a two-back system. Give me some Mayan Williams in the first series if it's an extended series, some Mayan Williams, give me some Trevion Henderson, have them spell each other, split those carries. If you want to go a 17 to 12 type of split, Henderson to Mayan Williams, great. Do it. I firmly believe a two-back system against Purdue, one, it's going to give you a different option, a different weapon, but two, it's not going to allow George Karloftis to get free and have the ability to get comfortable right there against Ohio State. I firmly believe Ohio State wins this game tomorrow. I have had people text me, and I know you have been out there. It's Purdue. Yes, Purdue is 6-3. I think that Nebraska will be one of the tougher tests this year for this Ohio State team. We saw a week ago. That was the game I was the most nervous about. I'm nervous about certain things with this Purdue team. Not as nervous as I was going into the Nebraska game. Ohio State wins. Really good shot of them covering the 21-point spread tomorrow in the Shoe. Thank you all once again for tuning in and enjoying another episode of Locked On Buckeyes, part of the Locked On Podcast Network. Your team every single day. One quick reminder, once again, make sure to go to the YouTube, Locked On Buckeyes, subscribe there, hit that bell as well when you subscribe so you're notified every time a new video goes live, because it will be live tomorrow, immediately at the conclusion of tomorrow's game against those Purdue Boilermakers, recapping, analyzing what we witnessed in that matchup. College football playoff, it's gotten a lot of attention lately. Every single Tuesday, we get the soap opera, the drama that is the unveiling and revealing, Gary Barta spitting nonsense out in regards to the new rankings coming out every single Tuesday. Now, I'm going to say something I wasn't planning on saying right now before going into the whole college football playoff, the new wrinkle that goes into the possibility of future expansion of the playoff. I'm not a fan of the committee. I'm not a fan of their rankings. I'm not a fan of that human element and how it's messing things up. I don't care for the coaches poll. I don't even care for the AP poll. If you want one poll that has been respected and used at different levels of football to grade and rank different teams, give me the Sagarin rankings and give me a bracket out of that. I think that the Jeff Sagarin rankings, look it up. I think you might agree with what is there. I have not looked it up recently. I looked at it earlier in the week, not before today's show. I firmly think the Jeff Sagarin rankings will be, and they are, the best way to rank teams every single year. It's a computer poll, a poll that's been put together, used at different levels. I have heard no complaints about that thing. I do think it's the best way to rank teams in college football. But you know, they want to make that money, and they want to pay some people. They got to pay these bills. They want to have more money to pay these bills. They're going to keep using those people in that committee. I think the Jeff Sagarin rankings will be the best thing out there for college football. I just don't think that's what they'll use to rank those teams that'll be in the playoffs down the road. The playoff format currently sits at four teams. Expansion hit, or talks of expansion in the offseason, a 12-team format. The top six, or the highest ranked, the six highest ranked conference champions, excuse me, would be the proposal in a proposed 12-team format. So we're at four right now. The proposal in the offseason was 12 teams. The six highest ranked conference champions would be the top six ranked teams, and then six at-large bids. Notre Dame would not, of course, they're not in a conference, so they would be in the at-large ranking, or basic, excuse me, you get automatic bids and everything else is an at-large. You're just going to pick you based off of how your season went, your record, your body of work, your resume, the eye test, the head-to-head, which still makes absolutely no sense, but they're going to keep spitting that thing out to try to make this thing make sense in their eyes, even though it don't make no sense at all. Well, recently, due to the alliance that was formed in the offseason, between the Pac-12, the ACC, and the Big Ten, they proposed something different. Their proposal was 5+1. The five Power Five conference champions get automatic bids, and the highest ranked Group of Five conference champion gets the other automatic bid, and then the six at-larges. Still, Notre Dame is still in the at-large billing. Their proposal is still a 12-team format, just like what we witnessed in the offseason. But theirs is 5+1, not six highest-ranked conference champions. If you look at the history of the college football playoff, most of the time, I believe most of the time, may have happened once where the highest-ranked conference champions were not all Power 5 teams. It's possible where Cincinnati this year will be one of the highest-ranked conference champions, and not all five conference champions will be Power 5. The five highest-ranked conference champions will not be all Power 5 teams. So I do see why they're proposing the 5+1 so everyone gets in instead of highest six, to where if there's a 4+2, let's just say at 1 year, the ACC is left out. You got the Big 12, the Big 10, the SEC, and the Pac-12. Those are the four of the six highest-ranked conference champions. Then the other two would be Group of Five, so the ACC is left out. That's highly unlikely to where you'll get six highest-ranked conference champions and there's two that are Group of Five. That's highly unlikely, but the Big Ten says to protect us, to protect the Power Five, so everybody else is in this because, you know, we got to protect each other. We're in this alliance together. Yeah, the 5+1, great. Just to play on words, really, it is a distinction from the other, but that is still a 12-team format. The Pac-12 conference, they're open to any of the three formats. So you're saying they're willing to go outside the proposal that the alliance put forward and the conference commissioners are currently looking over? That is correct. They're fine with the 12-team format, either the six highest-ranked conference champions getting the automatic bids plus the six at-larges. They're comfortable with the 5+1 model. All five Power 5 conference champions get an automatic bid, plus the one Group of Five highest-ranked conference champion gets that other automatic bid plus six at-larges. They're also open to an eight-team playoff format. Myself, I am still on the variety that there's no reason for expansion. I know there are 3 weeks left at the time of this recording for the college football season to be completed, plus conference championship week, which is at the beginning of December. There's a lot of things that are going to happen, a lot of losses, a lot of shakeup at the end of the season. If you got more than four teams that deserve or that are the best, if you have more teams that you believe are the best teams in college football, I may consider it. I may go six. Eight is my limit, but I don't believe in any season you'll have more than, trust me, in the time period of the college football playoff, have there consistently been five, six, seven teams that are the best teams in college football? Not really. Not really at all. But people want money. People want things. Oh, we want more people in the pot. Guys, trust me. A lot of people want that. Yes, it would be great for TV and all that kind of stuff. But when determining a champion, it should not be an invitational where everybody and their mama's coming in. It should be the exclusivity of this format should still stick. Doesn't seem like that's going to happen. Still an exclusive group when you look at 8, 12, maybe even 16 out of 130 FBS teams. I get all of that. I'm still stuck in my ways, the old ways. I'm a youngster. Give me four. We'll be just fine. Trust me, we got time between now and then to say that at the end of conference championship week. If there is more, I'll come over here and say, I believe there should be more teams in this because of this year, not because of the history of this thing. Oh, the big announcement. Almost forgot. I don't know how. Tonight, I will be covering my very first college basketball game in the arena. I will be at the Ohio State basketball game tonight against Niagara. I had my first time getting a media credential in the offseason covering the Big Ten media days in Indianapolis, Indiana at Lucas Oil Stadium. That was amazing. And then there are currently, I believe, four different basketball games I'll be at throughout the season, all in Columbus, trying to get some more, the Indiana game, trying to get the Purdue game when Ohio State plays them, still applying to get to those. But this is a milestone. I started podcasting in May of 2019. I joined the Locked On Podcast Network in September of 2020, covering my first big major event live and in person this year in July of 2021. And then in November of 2021, covering my first college basketball game in person. These are just baby steps. My personal career in sports media is slowly going forward. Some may say quickly, some may say slowly, but I am excited. And if anybody is out there at the game tonight, message me on Twitter at jstevens07. Email me, jstevens317@gmail.com. Maybe you're on the Instagram, you're not on the Twitter. Username is the same, at jstevens07, there on the Instagram as well. Message me. I would love to meet up and say what's up to some of the listeners of the podcast. I remember somebody yelling my name at the Indiana game when I was there. I turned around twice, didn't see anybody, keep waving at me. So if you're there, say hi. Say what's up. I will not be a stranger. I would love to meet some of you in person. Great things happening here for the podcast, just trying to give better coverage for you. And also trying to enhance the way that so many people enjoy Locked On Buckeyes on a daily basis every Monday through Friday. Guys, it's a Friday. We're closing up shop. Big game tonight for Ohio State, looking to go 2-0 on the basketball court tomorrow. Ohio State against Purdue. Ohio State basketball, let's get a win tonight. Ohio State football, let's get a win tomorrow. So we have more good things to talk about here on Locked On Buckeyes next week.